on this cold and wintry night. That piece wants to warm you up a little bit, a little idea of the Spanish fiesta music. This is a piece that's held a long-time special place for me. When I was a senior in college, our band director invited those of us who were seniors to come up and choose a piece. He had a bunch of pieces out on the table, and he said, choose a piece and you can conduct it on an outdoor concert, and the person who does the best job will get to conduct it on our band concert this spring. And so most of my colleagues rushed forward to choose the easiest piece in the pile, but I chose the most difficult piece in the pile, and it was this one. And I was fortunate enough to be chosen to conduct that with my college band. And that was really kind of the beginning of my thinking, I might be able to do this. I might actually be able to make a career out of conducting. And so we've played that about once every 10 years since I've been here, so it's been a while since you've heard it before. The next piece is in an entirely different style. It would probably be a little bit more like my colleagues might have chosen, in that it's slow and very, very lyric. One of the things that I think is kind of interesting, if you had a chance to see the program notes before the lights went down, is that Clifton Williams, who was a very popular composer of band music through the mid-20th century, and unfortunately his music doesn't get played all that much anymore. It's too bad, so I think as you can hear, he really had a lot of skill when he did. His office mate, that is the person right across the hall from him, was Alfred Reed at the University of Miami School of Music. And so I think it's kind of an interesting symmetry to play these pieces back to back. They were good colleagues and spent a lot of time discussing the state of composition for band. Reed wrote a lot of very fast, loud music as well. This isn't one of them though. A folk song setting that I think is absolutely gorgeous, based on Black is the Color of My True Love's Hair.
Thank you.
you're somebody, I know many of you are people who have attended symphonic band concerts over many years. This is really kind of a different style of music than we have typically played here. Stephen Reinecke is a young composer. He lives here in Ohio. Actually, my first introduction to him was, I was talking to a high school band director, a friend of mine, and he said, "Do you know Stephen Reinecke?" And I said, "Well, a little bit." He said, "I hate him." And I said, "Why do you hate him?" And he said, "Because he's younger than me and he's composed all that good music." Well, he's younger than me too, so I suppose I probably should hate him as well, but I don't. This piece has, it's a progress piece actually, and that, what I mean by that is that it has a story to it. But I didn't share the story with you in the program because I honestly think the piece is better without it. The story, I'm not crazy about the story, I like the music. It's the inspiration for this piece is Mount Pilatus, which sits on the shore of Lake Lucerne, just outside Lucerne, Switzerland. It kind of towers over the city there. My wife and I have been lucky enough to be there twice in the last 3 or 4 years. But it's really an amazing place, probably one of the most beautiful places that you can imagine. Mount Pilatus has two legends that go along with it among the Swiss people. The one is where its name came from. And the legend is that after the crucifixion of Christ, Pontius Pilate realized his role in the death and felt guilty about it and set out wandering the world to find a place where he could feel forgiveness. And the Swiss legend is that he ended up in Switzerland and climbed to the top of Mount Pilatus, which is 7,000 feet high, and stayed there until he died. And so that's where the mountain got its name. It's named after Pontius Pilate. But that's an interesting story. The second story is this. The top of the mountain is always sheathed in clouds and mist. So you really can't see the top. And it's pretty much always snow-covered at the top as well. And so the medieval people looking up thought that the smoke and the mist on the mountain must be because that there were dragons living up on the top of the mountain. And in fact, they named the dragon's name is Pilu. And if you go up the top of the mountain, there's a really nice gift shop there, and you can buy little stuffed dragons to bring home for your grandchildren, which we did. But unfortunately, I don't have my Pilu here to show you. I meant to bring, when you go up, you get a little hat that says Mount Pilatus, and I meant to bring that tonight, but it didn't go with my tux, and so I'll have to do that another time. Another interesting thing about Mount Pilatus is how you get to it. As I mentioned in the program, there's a cogwheel railway. What a cogwheel railway is, instead of an engine pulling the train, it has a cog on the bottom and sprockets, the other way around, sprocket on the bottom and cog, and it turns the sprocket and it pulls itself up the side of the mountain. And it's the steepest railway in the world. It reaches ascent heights of 48 degrees. You think, how high is that? Well, this would be flat. Yes, this would be 90 degrees, and 48 degrees would be about halfway there. And so when you're in that train, it's interesting because you're going up and you look out and there's nothing down there. All you can see is 2,000, 3,000 feet straight down on both sides of it. And so it's an amazing trip. I mean, it's worth going up just to ride the railroad that goes up there. So after the concert, we'll be organizing a trip to Switzerland. No, it's an amazing sight, one of the most beautiful places in the world. My wife went when she was in college, and so for 30 years, she told me what a beautiful place that was. And I'm really, really glad that we had an opportunity to go hear that. So this is a little bit different style piece for us. It kind of sounds like movie music to me. But it's interesting. There are a lot of cool ideas in it. And it's very exciting, I think, to hear. So you can put your own story in front of it. The story involves peasants and dragons, misunderstood dragons, of course. You didn't mean to eat peasants. They just did that by accident. And so you'll be able to hear.
Thank you.
1926, I believe it was, Holst was commissioned by the Brass Band Commission of England to write a test piece. And the way the test pieces work for brass band is different than the way we do contests here. In 2003, I was fortunate enough to go and watch the brass band contests in England, and it's really an interesting thing to do. The English are suspicious, I suppose, of other bands. And so the judges for the contest are enclosed inside a wooden box. They actually have a wall in front of them and a wall on both sides of them that's about 8 feet tall. So they can't see over it to see which bands are performing. There's a stage manager on the stage all the time. And if one of the bands knocks over a stand, for every band that comes afterward, he knocks over a stand at the same place. If somebody drops a trumpet mute, he drops a trumpet mute at the same place. So that those are not hints to the judge about which band might be on stage playing. That's really kind of interesting to see. So the judges can't see anything at all. And the way they do the test pieces is this. The contest is 2 days. The first day, everybody plays the test piece in a row. And so if there are 15 bands in the championship section, as there were the day I was there, all 15 of them will come on and one after the other play the same piece over and over and over and over and over again. And so it's really, really obvious when you hear that, which of the bands really excel and which ones don't really excel. The goal of a composer in writing a test piece is twofold. One, to be as musical as possible, but secondly, to write a piece that challenges and exposes every person in the ensemble. And so that's why you heard so much individual playing there, with one person playing and maybe one person accompanying, or nobody accompanying, or little things underneath that only one person does. Because it's to separate those bands that are just really at the very top from those that don't quite get to that stage. And so it's a fun piece, and I think the second movement is as beautiful as anything Holst has ever written. But it's really, really challenging to play. And so it's a lot of fun. It was fun for us to work on. The next piece, the Alleluia by Samuel Hazo. Hazo is another one of these young composers who's written a great deal of gorgeous music. He's written some fast pieces, and we've played a couple of them here. But where he really excels, in my opinion, is in the slow lyrical things that he writes. This piece, I told the band one time in rehearsal, I think this piece is beautiful enough that we could just play it 6 times in a row and just go home. It's just stunning in its beauty. It is based on a hymn, but only very, very, very subtly. And there are a couple of passages in here in which you'll hear, Hallelujah. And that's all that you hear, and it's about 6 minutes into the piece before you hear it at all. So it's not an arrangement of a hymn, but he's calling upon that hymn idea as well. If you've got a chance to read the program notes, Sam Hazel said that he was so appreciative to get a chance to write this piece, which was commissioned by an adult band, the Kalamazoo Concert Band in Michigan, a piece that really expressed his gratitude to God for the musical gifts that he's been given, and I think he did a smashing job with it. I love this piece. It gives me goosebumps and chills every time you play it. I hope it does for you too. If it doesn't, don't tell me, okay? Thank you. saying that, I think that there's probably no band director in the world who would knowingly schedule a band concert on the evening that his students had been out in the field in 20-degree weather playing for a football game, which my students were today. So they certainly deserve some credit for that. It's difficult under any circumstances. Yes, I think so too. Talk to those football coaches about scheduling it. Okay. The last piece, the Minnesota March, is one of Sousa's lesser-known marches, I believe. I'd never known it before we started working on it. It was the football coach at the University of Minnesota asked Sousa again in 1926, the same time that Holst wrote the Morsite Suite, to write a march for the school because he thought they needed something that was more energetic at football games. And apparently, this has become a school song for the University of Minnesota. I watched the Ohio State-Minnesota game, and I didn't hear their band playing it, but they lost, so maybe they weren't really, really in the mood to play march. So, but it's really a nice march. Sousa thought at the time he wrote it that it was the nicest thing that he had ever written. So I'm going to leave you on a real up note with the Minnesota March. Thank you.